Good afternoon. So yeah, I'm Jean-Christophe from Centrio, and I'm here to talk about some of our research at Centrio. So especially about anomaly detection for process variable tracking. So one of our research interests at Centrio is automotive security, and we did recently a study on the possibility of tracking process variables inside a car and by extracting the variable from the CAN bus itself. So here is the outline of the presentation. So I'm going to start by defining a process variable just to be on the same page. So for us, it's everything that can describe a process. So it can be any sensor readings, like pressure, a temperature, or anything like this. And I'm going to talk about what is done today in this field. And then we'll jump to our car and try to experiment on this traffic and on what can be done in terms of applying machine learning to the CAN traffic. And then we'll try to see if these concepts and the lessons we learned in a car can be applied also to more traditional process control and ICS. So process variable tracking is the monitoring of the process variables for different reasons. It can be for process control or in this context for cybersecurity. So in a cybersecurity context, variable tracking is finding anomalies inside the process variable information that could hint at an attack or anything malicious that could have happened in the process. So it's a very young field in cybersecurity. It's more mature in the process control field. When it is done, it's often someone who configure manually different thresholds and rules in a system. And then the system is checked at a regular interval. And if something exceeds threshold, or if some value is not in the acceptable range of the variable, it triggers an alert. So those kind of systems are often called expert systems, because all the knowledge inside the system comes from the knowledge of an expert who configure everything. So these systems work, but one problem is they do not scale well, because a lot of human interaction is needed and a lot of work. So there is a trend today for more passive and more autonomous approaches. More passive because it is possible to extract directly from the process variable information, and more autonomous because there are tools today that are able to learn efficiently the normality of a process and alert when there is a deviation. So those kind of systems are the one we are interested in this presentation. And we are going to try to apply this concept to a car. So I'm going to start by introducing some CAN basics for you to understand the rest of the presentation. So you may know already most of it, but in a car, different microcontrollers called ECU, for electronic control units, are communicating on a shared bus. And on this bus, they are broadcasting CAN messages. That means that everybody on the bus is able to read the messages. And these messages are really simple because it's a very old protocol. And they are composed of one CAN ID, or ID, and up to 8 bytes of data. So it's really small messages. And all the communication and the variable information inside the messages are vendor-specific. You cannot apply something you have learned on one automobile to another. And the speaker from Audi introduced you to the two famous security researchers in this field, Miller and Valasek, and they define three kinds of CAN messages. They are informative messages. They are the ones that are carrying the sensor readings and the process variable information. They are also messages that request something. So for example, one that says, I want to apply the brake. Yeah, there is a typo in this slide. And finally, there are some diagnostic ones that are used to diagnose the car when there is a problem. So as you might expect, once you have access to something that can send message on the bus, so once you have physical access, it's really easy to spoof messages. You can send a message on behalf of another ECU, and sometimes you can build powerful attacks on the car just by sending CAN messages. So I know for some people, having physical access is game over, but we see this as an overall security scheme where you also have to check if something is compromised, and one good way to do it is to monitor the CAN bus too. So the problem with spoofing CAN messages is that it can have a lot of consequences because the ECU make critical decisions based on the information in CAN messages. So I'm going to give you an example which is inspired but simplified from a real world attack which targeted Toyota, I think, and which was targeting the park assist system of the car. The park assist system is a feature you can find on modern car that help the driver park his car automatically. And this feature is handled by a specific ECU in the car, which may be named the park assist ECU. And when someone gives a park assist order, the ECU will filter this order based on a specific context. If two conditions are not met, these two protections, the order will be ignored. And these two protections are the car need to be at a low speed and the gear selection must have selected the reverse gear. So that means that there are two protections to prevent an attacker from activating the park assist in a dangerous way. So for example, in a motorway at high speed. So both conditions can unfortunately be sent by the attacker. He can send the information that the car is at a low speed, and he can also send a reversed gear selection on the CAN bus. And then, if these two connections are artificially met, the ECU is fooled into believing that it is safe to activate park assist. So that's just an example and a simplified one of an attack. But you see that when someone is tampering with the variable, it can have consequences. So before diving into algorithm design and anomaly detection, we need to have a look at what was inside our car. So we followed different steps that we are going to go through. So we used a specific car, for this study, which is a modern a 2016 car. And the first step is to capture the CAN traffic. So we used different CAN-specific tools that are available. And once we have this traffic, we can have a first look at where are the most changing bytes in the CAN messages, and that can help isolate interesting CAN IDs to analyze. The idea behind this is to find, for example, the speed of the car in the traffic or other process variable we may be interested in. So once we have gathered all this data, we have something that looks like this. So you have the different timestamps at which the different messages were seen, the CAN ID, which is also circled in red, and also the different byte values. So you have 8 bytes. So how can we manipulate these bytes to retrieve a variable value in the corresponding unit? So for example, the speed in miles per hour. So we have to guess where the variable was stored on the message. So for example, a variable can be stored on 2 bytes, consecutive bytes, and we have to retrieve the variable from this byte. Sometimes you have to add a coefficient and an offset, and then you get the expected value. So for example, the rotation per minute of the car engine, which in our case was between, I don't know, 1,000 and 3,000. Well, once we get the correct unit, we can be sure we had the good formula to retrieve the process variable. So here are some examples of variable we extracted from CAN messages. So once we know the formula to reproduce the value, we can plot a time series of this particular variable. So for example, the speed of the car, the cockpit temperature, there's a lot of things on CAN traffic, or the acceleration of the car, or the steering angle. And not every process variable has the same continuous look. Some have a particular look with a more discrete set of values. And one in particular was the turn signal, or the blinker. The turn signal, when you activate it, you either signal a left turn or a right turn or no turn at all. And actually, the process variable is stored in one specific byte that takes 3 different values. One for no signal, one for the left signal, and one for the right signal. And to be able to find this variable, we had to write down during our car ride the timestamp at which we activated the left blinker, the right blinker, etc., etc. And that's on the bottom, the time series of this process variable. So now that we have this information, we can start to experiment and build anomaly detection prototypes to detect attacks. So first, in every machine learning problem, you start by exploring the data you have. So we had a first look at the process variable correlation, because it's quite intuitive that there are many correlations between variables. For example, if you step on the accelerator, ultimately the speed of the car will increase. So there is intuitively a correlation between the speed process variable and the acceleration process variable. And as you can see on the right, you have a matrix where each square is a pairwise correlation between variables. So red means high correlation, and white means no correlation. So you can see that there are many variable couples with a good correlation. What's even more interesting is that these correlations are stable over time. So in machine learning, this can be very useful, for example, to use some to predict another. So you can probably build a formula that can predict the speed based on the accelerator, the gear ratio, etc., etc. And one of the opportunities that gives provide machine learning is everything, all these formulas can be learned automatically. So we decided to build a first demonstrator, and this one will be a speed predictor. So the goal is to predict the speed of the car in real time based on the process variable, based on over process variable. So we are not using the current speed, we are using everything else, so the RPM, the acceleration, etc., to build a speed value. So we used two car rides, ride one and ride two. We used ride one to learn how the correlations works and how to predict the speed, and ride two for testing. And once you have a prediction algorithm like this, you can use it to detect deviation. If the prediction, the speed value prediction, at the time gets too far from the actual speed value that is circulating on the canvas, it may hint at an attack, or at least at an anomalous value circulating on the canvas. So that concept and the idea to apply it to a car is inspired by the work of a security researcher called Jun Lee, who presented it at DEF CON last year. I don't know if you caught this presentation. So we start by building this prediction algorithm. So like I said, we are using everything but the speed value to predict the next speed value of the car. So we are using a specific kind of neural network, which is called LSTM. LSTM stands for Long Short-Term Memory Neural Network. And it's a very popular neural network to learn from sequential data and make prediction. It's used for different speech recognition tasks, but also it's used also for time series forecasting. So that's exactly what we need. So on the bottom, you see two time series, a time series in green, which is the real speed value extracted from the CAN traffic, and in blue, the one that is predicted from the algorithm. So you can see that they are very close to each other. So that means that we were able to build a prediction algorithm which is quite accurate and that can predict the speed value of the car in real time. So how can we use this prediction algorithm to build an anomaly detection system? So this works like this. We are looking at the pass values of different sensors. So for example, the RPM and the acceleration. We use it to predict the speed value of the car, so the N prime in purple. And we compare it in real time with the one from the canvas. And if this difference between the two, which can be called the prediction error, becomes too high, it can be an attack. So to evaluate the efficiency of this approach, we manipulated one of our data sets, the one for testing, right two, and we injected anomalous high-speed values in the traffic. And then, when we used our prediction algorithm and an anomaly detection system, it was able to predict the speed value in real time, And when we monitor the prediction error, there is a huge error during the attack, as you can see circled in red on the graph on the right. So it's really useful for to detect anomalies. And what's interesting too, it's really hard to fool, since the algorithm has learned to predict the speed value of the car from many variables. If an attacker wants to remain undetected while injecting new speed values, he has to manipulate all the variables we used for the prediction. And all the variables, speed value is correlated with. So it's really a hard task for an attacker. And he also has to do it gradually, because if he injects all the process variables with all the good interaction, if he do it right away, it will be detected too, because it will not have a physically believable look. So this first proof of concept showed good results, but for it to work, we had to extract the process information from the canvas. So we had to do this reverse engineering phase to understand where the speed value of the car was stored in the CAN messages. So it's something that we want to avoid. So we decided to have a look at the possibility of creating the same anomaly detection system, but with no process knowledge at all. So for it, we had to learn from the bytes themselves of the messages. So we use the same CAN captures as before, write one and write two. But this time we used a subset of CAN IDs. So we used only the messages in the traffic with from five different CAN IDs. It was to simplify the problem. And we looked at the 8 bytes of each of these messages. So we had in our system 5 CAN ID times 8 bytes of data. So that gives 40 features containing unknown data. So we started from these 40 features, and we built 40 individual byte predictors for each of these features. So for example, the first byte of this CAN message, we built a prediction algorithm which is specialized in predicting this byte. So we have different individual predictors, like the two on the right. So you see already that the prediction is possible, even at the byte level, without knowing what is actually there. So that's promising. And as always, we are not using the past values of the current byte we are predicting as an input. Why we insist on this? Because if we are using the value we are using as input to predict the same variable, we let the attacker a possibility to influence the decision-making of the algorithm. If we make it possible for an attacker to alter the input of the algorithm, it could contaminate the history that is used to make the prediction. So it makes for a more robust prediction algorithm. So now that we have 40 byte predictors, we have to keep the most useful. Why? Because not every predictor is equal. Some have learned some interesting things, and some have no clue at what this byte is doing and how to predict it. So we have to select them based on their performance. So you see on this bar graph the different prediction performance of each of our predictors. So we set a bar in red, and we took only the best predictor. And these are the ones we'll use to monitor the CAN traffic for anomalies. So now that we have only good byte prediction algorithm, we can see all these deviation time series, and we can already see that the attack is visible, even at this byte level prediction. But as you see, this is very noisy and not useful in this form. So we had to combine all these deviation errors into one consolidated anomaly score. And how to compute a clear and generic anomaly score? We used a weighted average of all the prediction errors. Why weighted? Because we want to give a higher contribution to the most efficient byte prediction algorithm. So the concept behind this is if a predictor is good at its task predicting, it should be more interesting to monitor an error. It should happen less often. So when you combine all these prediction errors into one consolidated anomaly score, you get this time series in orange. And you clearly see a rise at the time of the attack. So you have the information available to trigger an alert or put the car in safety mode or anything you like after having detected an anomaly. So to sum up, it is possible from raw data to automatically learn interaction between process variables and build machine learning models on top of this interaction and use this model to detect deviation. So we know it's a very particular case, very particular attack, and it's really simple scenarios, but it validates the principle of doing anomaly detection like this. So now the question is, can it be applied to more traditional process control systems? And the answer we have is maybe yes, because there are a lot of similarities between a CAN network and an ICS network. CAN is also in use in some industrial facility. The same, the protocols are as vulnerable. It's really simple, for example, in Modbus to send any data you want once you have a physical access to the network. And also, you have the same kind of variables. It's a temperature and a pressure is are a couple that is that have a strong correlation in any system. It's not just in cars that you will have this correlation. And since this correlation are the basis for our system, it should work. And the only thing is it might be less easy to extract the information and to find the interaction in an ICS network because the communication are maybe less frequent than in a CAN bus, and also because there are a lot of things in Modbus registers that are not physical values, or there are a lot of things. So here is to illustrate the ICS possibility. Here is an example. So you have a typical and very simple ICS process where a SCADA station is monitoring the process, and behind the PLC you have different sensors and actuators, and all this process is described by four variables. So variable one is one that is used to monitor the process from the operator's point of view at the SCADA station. And variable two, three, and four are the ones that are corresponding more or less to sensor readings. So for example, always the same example, but pressure, temperature, etc. And in this process, if we apply the concept of our anomaly detection system, we are going to build four variable prediction algorithms. And especially, we are going to build one for a variable one. And the machine learning training will try to learn a formula to link variable one to variable two, three, and four. And in the event of an attack, if an attacker is trying to fool the SCADA station operator by, for example, doing a man in the middle and try to inject fake values and malicious values for variable one, our algorithm, we detect a high difference between variable one that is extracted from the communication network and the prediction that is made by our algorithm. So again, that's very simple, but that shows that variables are everywhere and they must share interaction even in an ICS network. So as I said, there are a lot of complex interaction that can be found automatically by such algorithms, and you can build an anomaly detection system on top of this data. And what's maybe the most interesting fact about this little study we did is it seems optional to know where and how the process variables are stored in the traffic. So it could we could have thought that we needed everything about the process, a lot of process knowledge to build an algorithm, but this shows that you may be able to do interesting stuff too with no knowledge at all of on what you are looking at. And about our future work now, at Centrio, we are looking at harder to find anomalies because we know this one is really easy. It's an attacker that injects high speed value in a given time period. But also on more complex attack scenarios on cars and ICS systems. And also, this is just an example of a detection algorithm. There are many things possible, and we'll also work on different workflows and systems. So before I answer some of your questions, just a quick word about us. So we are, Centrio is a startup based in Lyon, in France, and we are developing an ICS security monitoring solution, and encourage you to have a talk with me if you want more information. So thank you for your attention. Hope you liked it, and if you have any questions.
Okay, we have some questions.
Yeah, Patrick McBride, thanks. I enjoyed the talk. The you had mentioned in, you know, somewhere down in your conclusion slide that having the what the variable you could figure out the anomalies without having to know anything about the variables, and you noted that the it looked like understanding what the variable was optional. I was wondering if you were to comment on if you send an anomaly alert on something. What do you have you guys thought through what you need to provide the operator about the anomaly or?
Yeah, that's a good question. But just an observation, and we know that such an alert will have little context, and it will maybe not be it will not be helpful as it is. So for it to work in a real life scenario, you may have to think of it as just a part of a detection system.
Kai Thompson, thank you for your talk. One quick question, how long does it usually take to create these workflows? So the amount of time you have to put into creating a particular workflow?
So you mean training the algorithm, the time it takes?
Yeah. and the amount of data you might need to have a stable workflow. So I can imagine for some processes like acceleration in a car, you just need that much data, but then some SCADA, some ICS processes probably take a very long time for the process to run, so probably much longer amount of time.
Yeah, I think you are right. It must be more difficult for different reasons in the ICS world, but it was just a quick study actually, and it was relatively it was easy to train. It was just like I don't know, 50 minutes training, and then when you ask the algorithm to make a prediction, it's quite you can do it in real time. We haven't tested it in a car. It was everything was done offline with capture of, from real car, real moving car, and it was based just on 10 minutes ride. So it's really not much data, and the two rides was were completely different. One was with one driver and following one path, and the other one was completely different. So we were able to learn not everything, obviously, but enough information from the first ride to have a good prediction on the second ride.
You know, I thought as I was listening, I clearly could apply to ICS. I see no difficulty at all in moving it there. And when you're talking about the training data, it actually is probably more simple in a traditional ICS because we have historians with months and years of data, maybe not every process variable, but some of the more important ones. So I think you actually have the data. I actually think it's probably easier to do it in a traditional ICS than in an automobile because getting that data off the automobile is maybe less usual than it is in an ICS where the data is always available. But I was thinking, you know, when you were saying an attacker would have to change all the variables that you're looking at to fool, it really made me think of Stuxnet, because they maybe anticipated such a thing in the sense that they recorded all the variables and replayed them. So, you know, and just kind of thinking out loud here, I almost wonder if you implemented something like this in an industrial environment, you would want the variables that you're tracking to come from a different PLC or controller than the one that you're attacking, or the one that you're worried about being attacked, because someone could replay, could basically record and replay everything on a single controller, but if there were some other unrelated variables, it might be a little harder to fool.
Yeah, but there are two things in what you said. One is a replay. During the replay, there will be no deviation because the interaction will stay intact, but there will also be no attack in it for us to detect. And also, when you start the replay attack, the first packet may be detected because it will be a jump from the last correct one from the first replayed one. And this section may be detected.
Well, so if I were trying to attack your scenario and the replay was just to fool the system to make them think everything was going on while they were actually manipulating the actual variables, your trigger could be record data, wait until the speed in the recorded data matches that, then trigger the replay, do the bad stuff, and go. It's really an interesting area to think about from both the attack and defense standpoint.
Yeah, from the attacker point of view, it's really hard, but it's also possible. If you have the knowledge and you know that such a system is in place, you can do everything.